You're watching West Hartford Community Television.
Welcome to Children's Books. We're particularly glad to have our guest tonight, Jane Pomeroy, a writer from Maine, because this is our fourth anniversary of taping children's books. Jane is a writer who specializes in short stories, but she has also branched out into research on the first American wood engraver, Alexander Anderson. We're glad you came from your island in Maine, and welcome you to our show to talk about, because I know you're in town to deliver a speech on Anderson, and we're happy to have you here with us. How in the world did you first get started? I know you had a letterpress business in Washington, but how did you get started being interested in Anderson?
Well, I started out, my first interest as a child was drawing and painting, and I thought that's what I wanted to do. And then I stopped and started to write and published a few things in little magazines. And then I stopped writing for various reasons. And then I went into learning how to set type and print at the Smithsonian. We were living in D.C. at that time, Washington, D.C. And my sister, who was a collector of English children's books, said, had I ever heard of Alexander Anderson? And I said, oh, yes, but it didn't mean very much to me. She said, well, have a look. And at the same time, I was doing a logo for a shop in Washington that specialized in Victorian clothes and memorabilia and so on. And I started to look into children's school books and saw wood engraving after wood engraving. And it just hit me. These things are extraordinary. So I started looking for Anderson things. And I looked and I got more and more and more embroiled. And my printing business was suffering. I decided that the day was only 24 hours long. So I had to do one thing or another. And then when we moved to Maine 10 years ago, I stopped my printing business and went full time into working on Anderson research. So that's what I'm doing now.
He's led a very interesting life. He was born in 1775.
And when this country was still a colony.
Right.
And he died in 1870. And it was an extraordinary span of time. His career lasted over 60 years. And he continued to work until he was over 90. 90 years old.
But he first started medicine and kept engraving all along the way while he was studying.
Much to his mother's fury, because they obviously, the life of an artist at that time was very insecure.
Of course.
So she told him that, in fact, trying to work in winter in the garret where he was living in their house where they lived was impossible, and he paid no attention, kept right on. And then in 1798, in the yellow fever epidemic in New York City, his entire family was wiped out. Absolutely everyone. Mother, father, brother, wife, infant son, mother-in-law, brother, and sister-in-law. And at that point, devastating as it was, he then had a chance to do what his first love always was, to engrave. And he never again practiced medicine, although it's said that he helped the poor as a doctor later, but he gave up his practice.
And so he devoted himself really full time.
By 1800, he was working full time.
Was he able to make a living from it?
Yes, he was. I think at first it was very difficult because most relief engraving at that time was on type metal and mounted on blocks of wood. And so when he came along and started to work on the end grain of boxwood, which is what he did, inspired by the great English wood engraver Thomas Billie, all the printers, of course, were very skeptical because wood warped and cracked and so on. Also, they were used to cleaning their type with lye and water. And, of course, you set block of wood in water, it's going to crack and break.
Right.
But he started out and he very quickly became extremely, revered, respected because of the quality of the work that he was doing. And this is one, an 1817 book that The Seasons by James Thompson. This is exactly the kind of work that he loved, these dark contrasts of black and white. This is a very finished engraving. Not all his engravings were of quite the same type. For his children's books, they were much freer. But when he was producing, began to produce work like this, and even earlier than 1817, which is what this book is, he was very quickly recognized. Mm-hmm. And this was the first, he was the first really relief engraver of any sophistication in American bookmaking. So he was, he therefore got more.
And it was really the custom of the time for the publishers to directly copy English books.
Absolutely.
Because we were young and developing, and they would get these books from England and tell Anderson to
copy. I would like to have more information on that, but as far as I'm, Samuel Griswold Goodrich, who was Peter Parley, as you know, better known as Peter Parley, said it, and he was a publisher himself in the 1820s and 30s, he said it was absolutely any American publisher who tried to put out things that were purely American, other than school books and almanacs, would lose his shirt.
Mm-hmm.
So, in other words, you had to ape the quality, or try to ape the quality, of English bookmaking.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of Anderson's first wood engravings were after designs by the English, and were relief rather than copperplate, because often he was copying copperplate.
Uh-huh.
But he translated the copperplate into his rich blacks and whites of a wood engraving.
I know I've been taken by having copies of the original book and then Anderson's copy, and you can tell he copied because the images are reversed, they're almost identical.
That's right.
I just found that absolutely charming and did not understand it at first until I started looking into it a little more. Very, very interesting.
Yeah. Oh, yes. No
Explain
question.
The difference between cutting on the end of a wood grain and on the flat surface.
Well,
because they were cutting previously on the flat surface of a plank, is that right?
That was true.
Mm-hmm.
And it was when you were cutting on the lateral surface, like the same grain as a floorboards in your house.
Right.
You used a different tool, you used knives, and it was difficult to cut across the grain because you've got your grain constantly there as parallels. And what you it tended to break down the lines, and then in the pressure under the press when you're printing them, that would also put extra stress. Now, when they used boxwood, and this is an example of boxwood, which is almost grainless, and when you did it across, cut it as cross grain, the wood was extremely strong, and you used a different tool, use the burin, which is like the engravers on copperplate, and so you could get very fine lines. It was a resilient wood, but it wasn't enormously hard. So in other words, it wasn't difficult for the engraver to use. There's a story, again put out by Thomas Buick, who said that he had a block which had gone through the press 900,000 times.
Oh my word!
The same block and was still viable. So you can see what an advantage from the point of view of the printers and publishers that you could just use and reuse and reuse these,
right.
these
but
blocks.
But it also meant that you have these tiny blocks this size because the boxwood doesn't grow large.
No.
And so then you had to, put them together if you had a larger picture?
If they were stuck together, and later on when we, Harper's Weekly and so on, they were clamped together with rods across the back.
Because the pages were this big.
Oh, yes, absolutely. And if you ever see one of those, they're an amazing thing, how they're clamped together, or else sometimes they were stuck together when they were big. But Anderson's mostly, I have not found any of his blocks that were treated that way. It was mostly small.
Right, because on some of Walter Crane's you can see the lines where the blocks didn't exactly meet, and you knew that they had put them together in a frame to print them.
That's right, and they warped often and separated afterwards.
Right.
This is another of Anderson's, again of the same, a finished style from 1822.
Oh, nice. Man fishing, like the outdoors.
Yes. Again, this is a very finished engraving, and for a more expensive book. It's Christopher Sturm, Reflections on the Works of God in Nature, 1822. And this was his strength, these blacks and whites, strong contrasts of black and white. And then we have also his work for children's books, which are, again, I think he loved that more than anything else. He was freer. He didn't have to copy and ape the English designs. He could relax and do what he wanted. And he often had a great sense of humor in what he did. This one here, the little girl, proud as punch, reading. You can just hear her voice, very loud, reading to her mother while her mother is sitting there relaxing and listening, and maybe a little bored, the mother. But anyway, the little girl is very proud. And
yes.
He put these touches in his children's. This is for Mary Elliott, Simple Truths in Verse, toward
this,
the end of
this was the size of the block, this was the size it printed, and the books sometimes were also this size.
Tiny, exactly.
So the tiny pictures just fit it.
That's right.
And tell me how you got these pictures.
Well, when I first started out in doing work on Anderson, I knew about a woman called Helen Newbell, mm-hmm. who had done what I am doing now, which is to prepare a bibliography of books at Anderson Illustrated. I couldn't find where she was. I had known she worked in the 1940s. Nobody could tell me anything about her. I thought, well, maybe she's no longer alive. And then one day I picked up a magazine on printing, the Colophon, and found out that she had lived in New Rochelle. So as she had an unusual name, I phoned information and said, do you know anyone by this name? Oh yes, there she was. So I phoned her, we became friends, I went to see her, and in time, she gave me all of her research, which was just amazing. So I think she was very pleased that I was taking up where she had been forced to stop. She didn't want to, but she had been forced to be very, very generous. And then later she phoned me and said, would I like to buy her Anderson collection? Mm-hmm. And her Anderson collection turned out to be about 200 or 300 blocks of Andersons. And it was, I was floating on clouds days afterwards.
Yes.
And as I was a printer, I was able to print them myself. And that was so exciting.
So these are the ones that you have printed from
original
blocks.
That's right.
Oh,
yes,
wonderful.
That's right.
Because the images are so perfect.
Yes, exactly. Mm. The printing technology, especially before about 1830, was really very rough. The paper was very rough. It was dampened when it was printed. It picked up too much ink from the blocks, mm-hmm. and there really was very little subtlety in the way these blocks were printed. But to see them now printed with new presses, good presses, are modern presses, and good ink, mm-hmm. is just a revelation. It really is.
Did you keep any of your presses?
Oh, yes, I have them. I brought them all to Maine.
All right, even though you were not in business, you still have the presses.
I couldn't bear to leave them.
I don't blame you.
I couldn't bear to leave them.
No, you shouldn't have given that.
Should I go on with these?
Oh, surely.
This is from somebody called a man called Newton Bosworth, who was the author, Accidents of Human Life, and it was a lifeboat scene. And you can see again his interest in caricature, the faces mm-hmm. in which he sees people often as caricatures, and a very vigorous. That was 1814. This one here is during the War of 1812. Now, Oh Grab Me is embargo written backwards. It was during the embargo, and this was showing how the New England merchants were not very pleased with what they had to put up with.
And I would not have recognized that by him.
No. He loved grotesque, and he loved caricature. And he admitted that that it was not fashionable to like the crude and the grotesque, but mm-hmm. he said he likes it. He said, I'm not ashamed to say that I do. So he was, he had very unusual qualities in the way he worked. He had to work for the market.
Yes.
And he had to produce what was.
Did he sign these AA?
Not all,
okay.
By no means.
Because once in a while I can find his little books with an AA
yes.
or an Anderson.
That's
sometimes
right.
Maybe only one cut signed.
That's right. That's right.
And then you figure, surely he did the rest of them because they look like him.
Yeah, oh, you're absolutely right. And the only way to really find out what he'd done is to look at the 17 proof books, his proof books, in the New York Public Library.
Mm-hmm.
And there are over 10,000 wood engravings. And those are the ones I'm working from because anything that was included in those proof books I know is his work.
Mm-hmm.
So I can match. All those proofs have no idea where they were, where they appeared, there's no date, there's no indication. So it's quite a job to match book to proof.
This has really been intensive work, I can see. And many libraries around the United States. Oh, yes, of course, I can tell you love it.
Yes. I love it.
Totally immersed.
This is from Anne and Jane Taylor, Rural Scenes or a Peep into the Country for Children. And this is typical Anderson, vigorous. It was a copy of an English one, but he added the beer stein on mm-hmm. top there.
But absolutely beautifully printed. It's so, so nice and crisp.
Well, it's what I said, it was a revelation to see what they really should look like.
Mm-hmm.
And it must
mm-hmm.
have broken his heart to see the way some
yes.
things were
yes.
printed. Again, we've shown that one. This is a tiny little one. which I don't know where it came from, but he was very, he came from a very affectionate family.
Yes.
And this shows through in the way he treats families. And this
in
is
fact,
one.
I have seen that picture
have
in
you?
Something. Yes.
If you let me know if you found it, because I have not found
very
it.
Very familiar.
Yeah.
And okay. But I don't know whether I found it in a book, a reference book, or whether I have saw it in the actual book.
Well,
I'll check it out.
Please do. Again, this is another very tiny one, but he put so much into these little tiny. He loved country scenes, he loved nature. And here is the very peaceful rural scene of the woman sewing and the husband digging beside.
And his eyes lasted through all these years of this tiny work?
He complained at the age of 80-something that he needed glasses.
Oh, my word.
Later on in life, this came from a book called A Collection of 150 Engravings by Alexander Anderson, engraved on wood after his 90th year. And this tiny little cow, which is very delicately done, is typical of the finer line that the new technology in printing was able to accomplish.
Mm-hmm.
He also had a...
Can you read?
Yes, thank you. He also had a love of the of macabre scenes, perhaps due to... He was a great admirer of Hogarth, and also due to the tragedy of his own family life.
Yes.
And this was, again, after an English engraving. And that one, again, now there's the, always the question. This is after Thomas Buick, and again done after his 90th year. And it's often said, ah, well, Anderson was nothing but a copier of Thomas Buick. However, if you look at the proof books, that you immediately realize that's absolutely ridiculous.
Because I wanted to hear your assessment of what you think of his talent.
He was inspired by Thomas Buick, no question. In August of 1795, he saw Thomas Buick's General History of Quadrupeds. And I think, although I can't be sure, that that was his first look of Thomas Buick's work. And he was really overwhelmed. I mean, he just said that Buick now has inspired me to perfect my work as in wood engraving. And all his early, a lot of his early work were copies of Thomas Buick's tailpieces and the animals in his General History of Quadrupeds. And Anderson himself did over 300 engravings for an 1804 New York American version of the General History of Quadrupeds. But as time went on, he did the, it was his, the way he learned, really. And then he did, and he in his old age, as I showed you that one, he also engraved after Buick, who he loved all his life. But he branched into other things.
Right.
And the proof books, as I say, with their 10,000 engravings, only a tiny percentage would be after Buick.
Well, was his first children's book Looking Glass for the Mind after Berkman?
Yes.
So that was his true first children's
that,
book.
Well, not his, it was his true, no.
He not had, really?
He, not really, but it was his first work on end grain boxwood.
Okay.
He discusses that in his diary.
All
and
right.
He started out doing them on type metal. And then for reasons that I can't figure out.
And I wondered if you discovered why he switched.
I don't know. I wish I did. I wish I did. I had racked my brains trying to find if he'd read something in an English periodical. But even Buick at that point was not recognized as, there was no discussion, as far as I know, of Buick's work on end grain boxwood at that date, which was 1794, when Anderson first started on those books. So I don't know. I don't know.
Because I wonder, maybe you'll discover it down the line. I'm curious, in his emblems of mortality, he was supposed to have yanked three of the cuts of Adam and Eve because they were, I'll have to quote, in various, quote, various situations.
Yes.
And I wondered if maybe it was, they could considered pornographic at that point in time. Was it?
Oh, yes.
Oh, okay.
But yes, absolutely. But as he was a doctor, he often, quite often, did engravings of bare-breasted women. And there's a marvelous Adam and Eve that he did, which is really sensuous. And but I think that his, perhaps as his training of a doctor, he had no fear of the naked body. And there's a very amusing one made for the book, made by the for the American Tract Society in the 1830s.
Of all people.
Of all people, right. And the first edition of that, Adam and Eve were naked. Well, the next edition, they weren't naked.
I'm not surprised. I'm not surprised, because this was a church publication.
Oh, right, of course.
And I don't think they would put up with that. But he also did now this tremendous 3-foot anatomical figure.
Oh, yeah, that was extraordinary.
And they're just a few copies, because the blocks broke? Is that the
story?
Well,
there is only one extant copy of the wood engraving.
Oh.
And it is in terrible condition. It's in the New York Historical Society. And it is an absolutely incredible piece of work. And then he did a copper plate of the male anatomical figure, but it was on copper. And that there's about three, I think there are about three extant of that. And it's a gorgeous one, too. Really, very, very striking.
And, of course, as a doctor, he was a perfect one to do this because he understood what he was drawing. That certainly helped.
It certainly did.
I was struck by his tie-ins with Connecticut because he and his family lived here for about 5 years. His mother was a Lockwood from Greenwich.
Absolutely.
He illustrated for Peter Parley, who was a Connecticut resident. And the fact, he also illustrated for the Babcocks, who had bookstores in Hartford and New Haven.
Absolutely.
So there are all these Connecticut tie-ins that before I didn't realize.
Oh, yes.
I find it fascinating.
Absolutely. And he was published everywhere, all over this, wherever there was publishing in this country. And a lot of his work for the American Tract Society ended up abroad. In Burma, I found books published in Burma.
You don't mean it.
Oh, yes. He used. And also a lot of his religious cuts that I have not seen in this country anywhere went to South America. So he really was very widely spread. At that time, he was by far the most sophisticated relief engraver.
Think of all the traveling you have ahead of you looking for things.
I'll never make it. I want to show one more, and often because books were English. But this one here, and amongst many others, this was Avis Holland, Tales of Old Times.
Yes.
And
he was prolific also, Holland was.
Yes, and this cut is a story of farmer, and the Indian came to him and said he wanted some cider, which the farmer had been used to supplying. And he brought a basket, and the farmer said, well, how can you possibly put cider in a basket? And the Indian said, well, I'll show you. So it was winter. He took it down to the stream, immersed it in the stream, hung it up on the tree, and it froze, and then his basket was filled. So this is an American story, and there were
Isn't
a lot more American stories, too, more than I think one realizes, but it was 1832.
How clever.
It is clever.
It really is clever. Very good. Show us the little piece of boxwood and the picture from that he did, because this is an original engraving block by him.
Yes, and I think it's very difficult to see, but really you've got to think of relief engraving like a first-class stamp you put on a letter. In other words, everything that's high, just put on your stamp pad is going to catch the ink. Everything below it isn't. So that's the way these blocks were done too. And this little fellow here is this is another kind of rather sweet, affectionate cut that Anderson did, and that's the block for it here.
Oh.
And then there's another one here. Again, an affectionate scene. This is Little Richard. The book is called Little Richard, A Story for Little Boys, and it was 1827. Oh. And again, the son wanted to steal those pears. And the father said, no, dear, you cannot do it. And so he's giving him a very kindly lecture.
Is this a Babcock?
No, this is a Samuel Wood.
This is a Samuel Wood.
Samuel Wood. And I've just found out recently that it was published in 1827. It was undated.
Lovely. And I know you also have some slides that you wanted to talk about.
Yes, I do. I would like to, like to talk about
some
slides.
Surely. Go right ahead.
All right. This one here was Anderson started what I think is the first bookstore to sell only children's books, and this was 1797. This was his advertisement in the New York newspaper, and this is Minerva, the goddess of wisdom, and she is stopping the little boys who are squabbling over marbles. This was typical of Anderson's feeling about knowledge and learning, and it was very crude. It is typical of his later engraving, of course, in a crude sense, but the way he handles the figures and so on. And then, of course, the devil is being speared by Minerva, by wisdom.
Wonderful.
Yeah. And so let's see now. This appears in the biography by Benson John Lossing of Anderson, and it's entitled What He Saw in the Fire. Now, Anderson, this is his interest in the grotesque, and his mother was, as far as the family is concerned, was mad. She was not mad. She had a medical.
Maybe schizophrenic?
No, not really. She had a metabolic.
No, did she?
Trouble. And she was fine sometimes.
She was in and out.
Yeah, and other times she was mad. And so he was very sensitive to this kind of behavior, and he at one point thought he was going mad too. So this that was typical of his interest in, mm-hmm. as it were, unusual. Here again is, this was from the Seasons, 1810, and it was a finished engraving. He did quite a lot of different series for the Seasons, James Thompson's The Seasons, and again, it's his love of the darks, the very strong blacks and whites.
Mm-hmm.
Here is his sensuous Adam and Eve, but went to Burma,
okay.
And very sinuous. I don't know whether it's sensuous or sinuous, but maybe it's both.
Probably.
And that was...
That's the one they yanked.
That's
No, they left that one in. Okay.
Here is another New York scene. This is a little girl running after her hat on the Battery, and that was published by Mail and Day, I think it was 1832. And in the background, you can see Castle Williams, so you know exactly where that was. But that was, again, another American children's books, an American scene completely. Here is one of his famous engravings for Mother Goose's Melodies, which his engravings only appeared, as far as I can see, in the 1837 edition. That was the first. And it popularized nursery rhymes, that book, put out by Monroe and Francis, helped to popularize nursery rhymes in this country. And they were very famous engravings, and they continued to be reproduced and used and so on much later. As far as I know, those were all his original designs.
Oh, great, so, yep. Because I have that and I didn't know.
Yep. Here is an 1833 Eliza Leslie, Atlantic Tales, and you can see here a finer line because of the new technology.
Okay.
And the different kinds of figures here who are much better dressed, and affluence is beginning to invade, as it were. Here is his masterpiece, which is a huge engraving, over 12 inches tall. It was after a Flemish engraver called Johann Elias Riedinger, and it was thought to have been engraved around 1818. It's an extraordinary piece. It's hard to see in small, but his reflections of the light back and forth and his darks and lights, and this is absolutely a masterful piece of engraving. And it was done on fruit wood, it is thought. Two pieces, two panels of fruit wood joined together because it would be too big for boxwood. Here we are, here's Anderson as a young man, and is thought to be, it was by Jarvis, John Wesley Jarvis, a portraitist, and Anderson was thought to be 40 at this. He looks much younger, but as far as I can find out from my information, that he was 40 when this was.
Well, this has been wonderful, Jane. I really appreciate your coming with us today. We've learned a lot, enjoyed your pictures, and we hope that our audience will also join us on the 15th and 16th of November at the Connecticut Children's Book Fair in Stowers, Connecticut. We have a lot of wonderful people coming, including Tommy DiPaolo, Susan Aller, local author, and Stephen Kellogg, among the many. So we look forward to seeing you there and again on our program. Thank you very much for watching. Good night.